trying to put that in diagram form, this is kind of what I came up with. So, you know, in this case, we were drawing from source material, from the two Alice books, and also kind of from the first game. And that gets put into a design brief, you know, in a document or whatever. And then you also have, we also had a schema. And the schema is the term I use to talk about how everything in this world is kind of connected but distinguished from each other. So we have this like organization for like, well, London is going to be like this. It's going to be desaturating gray, it's depressing. But Wonderland is going to be colorful and vivid because, you know, you're in the mind of Alice. And so that kind of informs, like, in every area, you know, what colors you're going to use, what kind of materials you're going to use. So based on that those two things are going to give us a whole bunch of themes and ideas to explore. The keyword being explore. So, you know, we just discuss this stuff and brainstorm, you know, what can we do with this? You know, and this is on every level. So, like, you know, in this hour-long chunk of the game, how are we going to design this? We're going to draw from these themes and ideas. Down to, like, individual objects, you know. What could we do with this object? How can we add something special to it? You know, who's got ideas for this? So you toss in random ideas. You know, the advantage of working in a team full of creatives is everybody has a different solution. Everybody has their own idea of what Wonderland could be. So you get random ideas tossed in, and then you iterate a lot. You know, even when you think your own is a really good idea, there is a feedback process. You know, sometimes even the best assets just don't work out. They don't kind of fit into the final product, and so you keep working on it. You have lots of people commenting on it. To give you, you know, more of an example of kind of how this works, here's a map of Wonderland from the first game. This is the loading screen, actually. And people really liked this. It shows all the different areas of the game and kind of your progress through that. And so when we were working on our sequel, early on in pre-production, we decided to make our own map. And we didn't have a complete design doc at this point, so we just kind of brainstormed, you know, what ideas would we have for places that we could visit in Wonderland. And some of them are from the book, and some of them are our own ideas. And you can see towards the top there, one idea is a land of dollhouses and doll pies. And, you know, this is identified as like, hey, this is something that we're all kind of interested in. Let's see some more. So, like all good designers, we did our research. And so we looked at dollhouses, these Victorian dollhouses that you have at the front, so they can open up, and the front wall comes out. And we thought, you know, there's a lot of possibilities there about, you know, like gating and like possibilities for gameplay, and the walls folding up. And then we looked at doll parks, and man, there's a lot of weird stuff on the internet. You could easily make a whole horror game just based on dolls, and you know, the horrible things that people do to dolls, and you know, there's all these like kind of themes that you can draw out of that, like people imposing their identity on the dolls, people talking to dolls, the childhood, you know, the loss of innocence, all these sorts of things. It's just really interesting stuff. And we thought it would be really interesting to combine this with the work of Mark Ryden. Fantastic illustrator, and you can kind of see how this would connect. You know, this stuff has all these themes of childhood and really trippiness. But most of all, I think we kind of borrowed this sense of color. You know, this very, very colorful scene, but also a little bit saturated, a little bit pastel. And so we brought all that together in this piece of concept art that we did early on. And I love this piece of concept art because it doesn't just establish a visual language for this section of the game, but it also has a lot of gameplay ideas. You can see all these little Alices like doing stuff with the doll parts, you know, having ideas for the gameplay. This came out at the time that we hadn't designed a lot of the gameplay. And then, you know, from all of this stuff, I can kind of establish, you know, this part of the schema. So, like, what is the brief for this? It's going to be giant dollhouses, and this is where we're going to meet the characters of the insane children. And we do our research, we're going to find themes from this. So all these questions that you can kind of fill in. And I give this information to the artists to kind of keep them all working together in the same way. And this is the end result, you know, drawing. learn from all these things that, that I talked about, we were able to come up with, you know, many ideas, you know, just combining, you know, the colors and the materials and the things that we talked about, and to create lots of, you know, characters and props and all this sort of weird stuff. I like this concept, I wanted to show this because a lot of you guys were showing me portfolios last night at the lounge. And one thing I was saying a lot is that there's a difference between illustration and concept art. The illustration is kind of art that looks good. It's art for the sake of art. It's like a book cover or something. This is more like concept art or concept design, where it's art as like a blueprint. It doesn't look good just by itself. It's actually made for a 3D artist, or it's made to inspire the rest of the team. You know, it has some other purpose other than just looking good. And you're allowed to have all these like photo references and all these like little notes and like have, you know, views of like stuff that you can't see in this one drawing. So there you go. Now I mentioned the word schema before. It's my word for like how we're gonna organize the world. How we're gonna make some sense of all this, you know, all these ideas, you know, put them together, but keep them separate so that we don't repeat ourselves too much. So I managed to get Star Wars from this presentation, and you know, this is from the first Star Wars, the first real Star Wars. And on the left there, you've got Tatooine, the dusty, earthy planet, and you see, you know, the colors are like tans. And, you know, natural colors, you've got blue skies, you've got sunsets. Everything is made out of, like, kind of ceramics or cloth or leather. And you've got this goofy dude with, like, the kind of this peasant haircut. And he's got natural clothes. And he looks like a nice guy. On the other hand, you've got the Empire. And you've got the interior of the Death Star, where everything is kind of factory-made. You know, it's, like, from the production line. It's mass-produced. Right, and the guys in the Death Star even look mass-produced. You can't see their faces. They don't have separate identities. They're all standing in a line. They're all doing the same stuff. And so this is a way of this was the schema for the first Star Wars, like keeping these two worlds separate, you know, by giving them, you know, different colors and different, using different materials and having these different ideas of how these two worlds were constructed. The same with Toy Story. You have these two characters, and they're kind of from two different worlds. You know, Woody, you know, is made out of cloth, and he has these kind of natural, friendly, down-to-earth colors, cowhide, leather. And on the other hand, you've got Buzz, and Buzz is made of plastic. He's almost entirely made out of plastic, and he's like got this futuristic, kind of trippy green and purple color scheme. And you know, he's got stickers and he's got LED lights. So, you know, clearly they're from two different worlds, and you know, they play against each other like that. Lord of the Rings, fantastic example. You know, I learned so much just from, you know, looking at the behind scenes stuff of Star Wars and Lord of the Rings. I love that, you know, the elves have this like cursive kind of theme flowing throughout their whole culture, from their writing to their armor, to their architecture. Everything is kind of flowing like nature.